People moving out, people moving in. Why? Because of the color of the skin.
Run, 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 but you sure can't hide.
And I, boy, and I, a tooth for a tooth. Vote for me and I'll set you free. Rap on.
Talking about love, man, brother, is the preacher. And it seems nobody's interested in learning but the teacher. Segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, aggravation, humiliation, obligation to my nation.
Welcome to T-Bone's Best of Roanoke Show. Music, comedy, and conversation featuring HB, the Honey Badger.
Honey Badger don't care.
Now, on with the show.
This is Radio Free Roanoke, and this is episode number 70, T-Bone's Best of Roanoke Show. HB, we brought back one of our favorites. He's here to talk about music, sports, and whatever the heck he wants to bring out. He's nationally best-selling author. Renowned educator, Roland Lazenby. Roland, howdy, welcome back.
Well, thank you guys for having me back, dear.
Yes, welcome.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things this radio station is all about is music. And I've read some of your posts, and you mentioned the other day that growing up in the 60s, listening to AM radio was such a powerful influence on you. And it just so happens today is Keith Richards' 76th birthday. So
he's a spry young fellow.
He looks it too.
He still has the mojo.
Mm-hmm.
But take us back to your thoughts on that. Growing up in the 60s, you know, we all grew up here in this room in the 60s. But take us back and tell us what you were thinking then. What influence it had on you?
Well, soul music was the foundation of everything, and soul music,
right,
to this day is so fabulous. And then along came rock that really just grew right out of the blues, like the Stones, all those British bands. And so they all ended up on the local radio, and all the music that was being written and played, I mean, it's all being played today. I mean, the bands are playing in one derivative of it or another, if not the same thing. And people still are scooping it up like ice cream. It's what, whether I'm in a brewery or in a concert hall or wherever, it's usually what lights people up.
The 60s music?
It does. And again, a lot of times in derivative form, but yeah. So much of what our music world is today, yeah, came out of that era, and the 70s too, right. But the 60s was really the seed of it all. Mm-hmm. It just, and I, you know, you're getting the erudite opinion of a guy who can't play a record player. So.
But you've got good ears.
Yeah. Well, I can hear when the dinner bell rings,
yeah,
and that's foundation enough to listen to music.
But a lot of that music, Roland, as you know, they use it on commercials still. 50 years later, it still holds up.
It does. I try to change channel if I hear it. I don't want to.
You know.
I mean, you get enough plays. What's it, Neil Young song, This Note's For You?
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, that's one I notice. If something is, it stays around when I use it for advertising. And it's kind of neat. I like that because it'll bring back memories for me.
I don't resent it. The artist, I'm happy they're able to, you know, and I say this even more about contemporary things, that because you'll hear songs that become popular today. The road to that is harder, particularly for rock bands.
Yeah.
Well, you'll hear songs come along, and suddenly, the next thing you know, they're on a commercial. And my reaction today is, well, thank goodness that band's getting paid, because, you know, yeah, you can have a million downloads and get a tenth of a penny,
right,
each.
Yes, it changed.
So it's the economics of music.
Being able to share is, yeah, what happened to music, I think, more,
yeah,
than anything.
It,
and you, yeah, had a handheld device that could record something, and do a real good job at it, and video.
Right.
And it changed a lot.
It eliminated the royalty structure for a lot of it. I really haven't sorted out the mathematics of that. There were there were a certain number of bands. There weren't as many bands back in the day. But the bands that were good were there were really good. And they got paid and they had recording deals. And today, how many hundreds of thousands of bands are there? Millions of bands. And so the technology and the growth in music education has given us huge numbers of musicians. There's just not the economic avenues for them, except for live performance. Right. And so the recording revenue is almost gone, except for like top country acts and top, really top acts that manage to get a hold of a good piece of the mass audience.
Right.
Well, touching back one more second on the past, any favorite acts from the past that you still will occasionally put on the
track? Oh, I listen to them all the time. I treat my Facebook and my Twitter page like my local newspaper. I'm the publisher, and I'll find things I want to throw up. And I do with music, too. I'll do everything from giving another spin to Brooke Benton, Rainy Night in Georgia, which I used to listen to when I was 14, coming out of Nashville. I'd be going to bed at night, or I'd hear Joe South. You know, I liked all those. And they were sort of Southern artists then. They weren't right in the music establishment, but you get those radio stations, you could hear, the games people play by Joe South.
Oh, yeah.
But all the big name people were there. There were a lot of them, Creedence, Neil Young, Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young, all the old soul acts, Marvin Gaye, just the Temptations,
Four Tops.
All of that stuff was just, I still listen to that today. I'll just get in the mood and share different things, but I go back through a lot and listen a lot, and I'm out listening to a lot of live music, so I enjoy that.
You know, I was listening to an audiobook, and it was about Pat Riley. And Pat, the coach of the Lakers and Knicks,
right,
and that, but
right.
His favorite song was My Girl, and he put on the 50th anniversary for his high school, and he brought in the Temptations to sing My Girl at the 50th high school reunion.
What was left of them? Of course, Pat's up there, so there are probably still a few of them left. I'm writing about Pat right now, so that's it. That's a good tip for me. You guys came here and helped me with my research.
Did you go to Woodstock, Roland?
I did not. I was, I was 15? No, I was 16.
Did you realize it at the time that it was going
to happen? Oh, yeah. My grandmother had a little hotel, motel, her house. She had about 10 rooms in it, and I'd have to stay at her a lot. And this was in Whitville. She got Life magazine, which was like getting, it's just exotic.
Mm-hmm.
There were three channels you could get, two of them good. Back in Whitfield in the 60s, there just wasn't a lot of media. Local AM radio, WYVE, where I talk about, they'd have good people playing all kinds of music on WYVE. Roy Stanley, the late great sportscaster here, was the DJ part-time on WYVE, and he was always putting some kind of great music down. He was a dear friend of mine. And that Life magazine, from the time I was about 10, 11 years old, really was my key to any sort of understanding of popular culture. But between that and television, it was enough. There was plenty.
Well, we're here with Roland Lazenby, author of over 60 books, and I would call him the dean of the local music scene as well. And let's talk about local music.
Well, that makes me laugh. I'm not the dean of, I'm not the dean of anything, including my own house.
But Roland, you went to the College of Musical Knowledge.
Me and about 100 million other, but that's all right. We're all we all have a good time with it.
But a lot of times I see posts where you'll highlight a show coming up locally.
I do. I love the Harvester. I volunteer with them a little bit. You know, I have a son as a musician. He's played music for 15 years.
Henry?
Yeah, my son Henry. And we just always, I've had the good fortune to, over the years, to go to some just amazing concerts while I was growing up, all through, you know. I missed the period there. I served 3.5 years of barracks confinement at VMI, so I wouldn't. But even then, VMI brought the Birds in.
Oh, my. Turn.
And yes. And Tina Turner, different amazing acts. Now, if you're on barracks confinement, you couldn't go. But they had these things called fire sentinels where you could work off some of your penalties, you know. So you'd have to put on the cross belts, and you're supposed to go around telling everybody to put their cigarettes out. But mostly what you did is sit up in the balcony and listen to the music. Yeah. So fortunately, I was a fire sentinel for the great concerts. The Birds were just incredible. And Ike and Tina Turner. She warmed hearts, you know, a cold place
like
that.
Oh, gosh, yes.
She was so incredible back in 1970, it was unbelievable.
Yeah, now, as far as, I'll say this just because of my age, I moved to Roanoke in the mid, late 70s, and they had WROV AM,
right,
I believe,
right.
And they had Tim the Music Meadows was one of the DJs. Did you ever heard of him?
Okay. I didn't get to Roanoke till 1980.
Okay.
Well then, one last thing on music, Roland. 5 Points Music Sanctuary. We interviewed them last week. Have you ever been to any shows that
I was before? Just there. I've been to a number. Oh. It's important. 5 Points is. I love the Harvester. Mm-hmm. It's a fabulous listening room. It has a big budget. It has found economic success bringing in incredible acts.
Yes.
And I've heard so many there. Everything from Rodney Crowell to, Graham Nash, all down the line. Just, the Zombies was an incredible show there. Yeah. That guy's 73, 74, and his voice is still just like a teenager's, you know. He's up there singing and so proud of that voice. And the music, was just seminal, I guess is the word, in American pop rock. But I've heard a lot of that, but the Sanctuary, and it's just such a place where you can go in Roanoke, mm-hmm. and the acoustics are fabulous, the interior design is great, and it's really sort of a community around the Sanctuary. Yes. And they make an effort, they really do, to bring in acts that you want to go and just listen to everything they're doing, and it's a great place to listen. And so the Sanctuary and what those folks are doing, it's really special.
Good strong stuff. And is there anybody left on your bucket list to go see that you haven't seen?
You know, my bucket list is more like a swimming pool. But well, I got to hear Van Morrison. Somehow I had missed him. A lot of the people I would like to see are dead. Fortunately, I saw some of them I saw Lowell George and Little Feet before he died. But
I see the bright lights of Memphis and the Commodore Hotel. And underneath the street lamp, I met a Southern Belle. Oh, she took me to the river where she cast a spell. And in that southern moonlight, she sang that song so well.
Gary Jackson, you know, who is the maestro at the Harvester, he used to do Kirk Avenue.
Yes.
There was this band coming through called Trampled by Turtles, you know, and they weren't real big then. And he had a show one night where there were about 10 people in Kirk Avenue to hear him.
Pretend that I don't love you. You could never pretend that I'm your man. That's exactly the way that I want it. It's exactly the way that I am. And you call me in the morning with your troubles, taking it downtown every night. I could never place the stars at night above. Got my hands on the ground and you know I'm right. You wait so long.
Of course, it was a year later, he put him on out of town, outside of town here, out of in Botetourt, and I think they had close to 1,500 people just there to hear them, which are big numbers for, you know, entertainment in our area.
Right.
I will add this about the Roanoke music scene.
Yes.
It's fantastic, and you don't have that in every city. Charlotte's music scene is, they're writing about how it's dying off. Obviously, Asheville has a really good music scene, but I'm not sure that people in Roanoke fully understand what they have here. And some of it is due to all the breweries, because they have created an economy for musicians. Yeah. Now, there have always been clubs, fantastic clubs like Martin's, right, or Blue Five, right, that are later night. Yeah. But the brewery hours usually run 6 to 9 or somewhat, and that's just a time when people can come in. A lot of young families can't go to the clubs. A lot of baby boomer music fans don't want to start a show at 10 o'clock at night. But man, they love going in these breweries. And so it has connected the audience and the musical acts, and there's just an array of really fine musicians in Roanoke. It's a good culture, and you know, Roanoke's a place where people come in from out of town, the bands, they really want to come through here playing, and we get the benefit here of, you'll have touring bands that charge a lot more,
right,
at bigger cities, but they can stop off here, especially those bands that are sort of mid-level. They're either on the rise or they're starting, right, to dip down a little bit.
Elmwood Park stuff.
Yeah, or even, you know, even Martin's.
Martin's is great.
Right, or the Harvester, or the Sanctuary. It provides legitimate venues where people know what they're doing, because you look at a place like the Sanctuary, you just can't be any old guy staging music. They know what they're doing in there. Yeah. They stage events well. Harvester, obviously, is brilliant at it. Jeff Center, same way.
Yep.
And so, you know, there are times, now, sometimes these acts coming through, the local venues have to pay a lot of money. It would shock you, some of the amounts of money that these venues pay, particularly Jeff Center and the Harvester.
Mm-hmm. Big money.
Big money.
That's a great point you just brought up. We interviewed Tad Dickens, Roanoke Times music writer, and he said, you know, Roanoke might not be a great, great music town, but we have loads of talent and a lot of good acts come through here.
They do.
And we just need to support them.
I think that... I think this place is a small city.
Yeah.
Now, the region's pretty good size, but you can have quite a commitment if you're living out in Craig County or... you got a lot of commitment to drive in and go to a music event.
Right.
And so I just think I've been watching it 15 years, and I think the progress has been dramatic. It's not perfect. We're not a great big city, but being a great big city doesn't guarantee that you're going to have a music culture. No. One of the things is just... there are a lot of really fine writers from this area. And conversely, there are also a lot of really fine musicians. Mm-hmm. You know, Franklin County is that place has been a breeding ground for musicians for a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you get Roanoke and Salem. I mean, all these communities around, this is just... I don't know, it's the Blue Ridge Mountains. It's got its own sort of flavor.
It does.
And if you love live music, and fortunately there are a lot of people who do, you can find it every weekend.
That's what, you know, I've had friends come in from out of town, and it wouldn't be necessarily a Friday or a weekend, and you can go to Martin's on Tuesday night and hear live music.
You can.
You know, so you can find it, you know, right. And I'm sure there's others. Places, you know, the Spot. I don't know how often the Spot has bands, but
it has them with regularity. Not on a Martin's has a,
right.
You know, it makes Tuesday nights a point of, in its focus. Well, actually, it makes all nights except Monday and Sunday.
Is that the answer?
Yeah, okay. Martin's really is an aggressive music venue,
and they're expanding down there as well.
They are. Yeah. They're making some changes, but Jason Martin has been doing this better than 15 years, and he really has. And he, you know, he is able to expand those larger outside shows where he'll have three or four bands and bring in two big ones from out of town. I really don't think you can discount the impact of Floyd Fest.
Mm-hmm.
Across the Way Productions.
We're here with Roland Lazenby, one of the many books he's written. He's written over 60 books, but one of my favorites I've listened to is Michael Jordan the Life. Let's talk basketball and sports just for a few minutes here, Roland.
Sure, happy to do it.
You mentioned you're working on a book now about Pat Riley.
Well, actually, it's The Life of Magic Johnson. Ooh, but Pat Riley is...
he's in there.
Yeah, I write these big biographies, they're way too long, but I get all the families involved, as many great-grandparents. I want the whole cultural thing to go right into this age of basketball where, I mean, the amount of money and these primo, you know, they're the select few, they become global cultural figures.
Yeah.
My Jordan book's in 15 languages, maybe 16 now. It came out 5 years ago. Those foreign language licenses they get, it's very rare for companies to renew that. You know, a book will have its run.
Yeah.
But they're coming back from Italy and the other places and renewing those licenses for another 5 years.
Good job.
Because I hadn't done anything to do with me. I might as well be, I don't know, average Joe under the byline. They're buying the daggone books because of that name above the picture, Michael Jordan the Life. But it is a cultural story. Their lives, the lives, you know, it takes a lot to be great at anything. And none of that ever happens in a vacuum. Mm-hmm. It's for one reason or another, you're the product of great families for our great trauma to great families. And so all that is a sort of a saga.
Both the books I've listened to, Michael Jordan the Life and Jerry West, you do really dig into the cultural.
I went way back to Jerry West because that's my father's people. He's a gentleman of, you know, the Southern Appalachians, Jerry West and my father. My father was one of these old two-handed set shooters out of the hills of Southern West Virginia. And I wanted to tell the whole story. Yeah. And the West story is amazing because his great, 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 I forget how many great grandfathers was a colonial governor of Virginia. You know, in the West were the De La Warrs. Yeah. And the Delaware is De La War. Delaware Indians, Delaware River, state of Delaware, that's all named after Sir Thomas West, one of the very earliest guys, major figures in the Virginia Company. Mm. And you know, it's quite a saga how Jerry's branch of the family coming off all that money ended up being dirt scratching hillbillies over in West Virginia.
Wow, they did.
Who had nothing.
And with the Jordan book, I know you went back to like his grandparents and great-grandparents.
They were moonshiners and sharecroppers.
And they were tenacious.
Well,
and
oh, yeah.
You can just see where it comes down.
Right. And you look at the... I'm back down in North Carolina with Magic Johnson's people. But Jordan's people, his great-grandfather was 5'5 and crippled. And he was a tough bird. They, you know, the funny thing is Jerry West people were all river rafters, which is... was the hardest core bunch of roughnecks you could ever get. Because before we had highways, everything was moving on the rivers.
Right.
And Michael's great-grandfather was working on a river. He was crippled, but he was really strong and tough. And he, Michael lived with him until he was six. And he died when Michael was 14.
Yeah.
But he was the dean, speaking of deans, now he was a real dean.
He was the dean
of that family. And I write these as black power stories. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Not the black power of protests
right. And
politics. There are all kinds of black power. And I've got an amazing black power story with Magic Johnson.
Now, he's, you know, when I think of Magic, I think of, you know, Michigan. Where's his family from? North Carolina?
Well, I've got two cultures I'm writing about, Mississippi and North Carolina.
Oh, okay.
And so a lot of interesting things there. Having a lot of fun with those interviews. Hundreds of hours of interviews. We're trying to get them transcribed. It's the hardest part when you're transcribing interviews is having to listen to your own voice over and over. And man, it will just go like, will you shut the hell up? Let the people talk, you know? It's terrible. I'm a great interviewer, and I'm an absolutely terrible interviewer. Because I get so excited, I talk over them.
Yeah.
And just having to transcribe that is torture. And so I've had a lot of fun with all the many people listening to their stories. People played against him. Mm. His coaches, mm-hmm. You know, a lot of stuff there I never realized. The one thing I try to do is find the stories that are really the story, mm-hmm. that have never come to light, mm-hmm. never been emphasized.
Yeah.
Because people who are famous, they would like to control their own narratives.
Right.
They don't want a lot of those stories out. Now, it doesn't mean they're bad. They just don't want to deal with it.
Sure.
They don't want to have to answer questions about it. But it's those stories. You think about the stories in your own life that you sort of hide or you're reluctant to try it out in mixed company. And they really, a lot of times, tell the story of who you are and where you came from. So,
well, both these books have told me, and I've learned from them things I did not know, and I tend to keep up with sports figures like that, but there's just so much in there. So I'm looking forward to Magic Johnson.
Thank you, T.
Now, as we get close to Christmas, Roland, as we wrap up here, what kind of books would you recommend to the audience that you might have read this past year or over the past few years? What kind of things have caught your eye as far as books you might recommend to somebody?
Well, I'm terrible. Because I have to get so deep in the research, it's hard for me to even hold conversations. It's sort of like being an air traffic controller. You're
just in it.
I've got to get all this stuff straight, and I don't have a whole lot of brain capacity. But I will start with it. Anything by Beth Macy.
Yep.
She's incredible. Mm-hmm. She's done something nobody else could ever do. She has taken life in the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's Factory Man, mm-hmm. whether it's True Vine, mm-hmm. and sadly now Dope Sick, which focuses on one of my former basketball players who died as an addict. And so she's taken any of those and made them relevant to the world, mm-hmm. which when I was starting out in writing, I could never imagine anyone being able to do that. So I think she has to top the list.
Roland, I want to thank you for coming in today.
Sure. Thank you guys for having me.
I want to wish you the best as you go into 2020 with your new endeavors there. And,
I wish you guys the same.
Well, thank you.
And
so
hopefully
much.
We'll see you at Five Points Music Sanctuary or the next Woodstock.
I hope so. We got a Woodstock scheduled at the Harvester again. Oh, we had a big, cool. We did a big successful Woodstock 50 at the Harvester.
Oh, okay.
And so we're doing Woodstock again in August, on August 22nd at the Harvester. Local bands do it, and they sold lots and lots of tickets.
Well, I'm glad.
Everybody had fun. The Woodstock show is proving to be a good thing for them. Yeah. And it's good for the, you know, we got some really good local musicians involved in it.
Yeah. Rocky Mount Stock.
Yeah, there you go.
It's always a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Wow, totally enjoyed it.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Sure.